Hi friends, welcome to EduTab. So welcome to this video one where we're going to have a discussion regarding the taxonomy of fish and the various ocean zones classification. Let us begin with it. So friends, this is a very basic video where we shall see some of the very important points and it will help you build your fundamentals. Okay, so let us start with this picture which you can see on your screen. So let us just quickly go through the parts of a fish. So here if you see, the mouth is given. Then we have nares. Nares are actually the paired nostrils. It helps to detect odor. Okay. Then we move on to the respiratory organs of fish, which is the gills. Okay. And there's usually operculum, which is a gill cover. And this operculum might be very prominent in some species of fish and it might not be very prominent in others. Okay. So we need to have a look at it. That is not very important for us, just for your information. Then coming to fins, we have, based on the location of it, there are various names given to it. Like you can see the one at the ventral side, you can see it is called the pelvic fin. Then at the side, you can call it as pectoral fin. On the dorsal side, you can call it as the dorsal fin. Then this is a lateral line, which you can see here, right? Then at the end, you have a tail, or it's called caudal fin. Okay, so tail is also called as caudal fin. Then you can see at the ventral lower portion, there is anal fin. So just graze through these parts. So just quickly, obviously the tail is going to help it move along. It helps in motion, a movement rather. Then the streamlined shape of the fish actually helps it to move fast or swim fast. Just like how boats have a streamlined shape. Then we have the fishes usually have good eyesight that would help it in seeing in dark water. Then as we have mentioned earlier, gills are for breathing purpose as human beings have lungs. Then fins also help it to steer and balance. So balance is a very important function that the fins perform. Okay, so this is important. Now let us move forward. So friends, now let us have a look at the taxonomic classification of fish. Now when we tell fish here, we are referring to those fishes that have fins, okay, that bear fins. Just keep this point in mind. So basically when we talk about the taxonomic classification, let us just have a look at the hierarchy. So we're going to have a look at which kingdom it belongs to. Under kingdom, we have a phylum. Then moving on, we have class, we have order, family, genus and species. There are other classifications in between as well, like under phylum, there's also subphylum. Just make a note of it. Okay, and after that, we can also have a superclass. And then we can have a class. There are order, there's family, genus, species, and they can be subspecies also. So just have an idea regarding it. At the right hand side, you can see a picture with the source of which is NCRT. So you can see that under the Animalia kingdom, these are the various phylums that are present. Okay, so if you're just concerned about it, just have a look at the names. Porifera, Coelenterata, Ctenophora, Platyhelminthes, Ascalminthes, Annelida, Arthropoda. Now when we talk about prawn culture, we shall be talking about Arthropoda because prawns, crabs, all these come under this particular phylum. Then we have Mollusca, we have Echinodermata. When you talk about starfish, it comes under Echinodermata. Then we have Hemichordata, and then finally we have Chordata. Now the concern for us is regarding Chordata, because fish, those bear fins are placed under this particular phylum, Chordata. So kindly note this point out here. Now let us just see which subphylum it belongs to and which superclass and class it belongs to. Okay, these are some of the four things that we're going to see in the next section. So here, as we just saw that the phylum was Chordata and the subphylum is going to be Vertebrata. Now friends, we're not going to mention or discuss regarding why are they placed in that particular phylum, why are they placed under the subphylum. So now these are the points that become too much of technical and it is not in the scope for our examination. But still, we have mentioned the reasons in the document. If you are really interested and curious to know, you can kindly have a look at those. Right now, we are just having a discussion to just build up our certain level of understanding. Okay, then under this vertebrata subphylum that we are seeing, there are two divisions that are made. Okay, one division talks about those organisms that lacks jaw. Okay, it is called agnatha, and one division talks about those organisms that bears jaw. Okay, that is Gnathostomata. Under this particular division, we have a superclass. Okay, so there are two superclass division. One is Pisces, and the next is Tetrapod. So we are going to have a look at this superclass of Pisces. Okay, the fishes that bear fins. Under this, there are two classes. Chondrichthyes and Osteichthyes. So what we are going to be doing is we are going to have a look at the features of this Chondrichthyes and Osteichthyes, just the important points, and then we shall have a look at this class as well, that is Cyclostomata. And why are we having a look at this particular class? Because these are ectoparasites on fishes. They live on their ecto means above, outer, okay, not inside but outside the body, okay, of fishes. So let us just quickly have a look at the important features. So friends, let us just quickly have a look at class Cyclostomata. So we have already seen the important point that it belongs to a division of organisms that lack jaws. Okay, and the next important point that we saw that most of the living members of this particular class are ectoparasites on some fishes. So these are enough for us. And then if you refer to the example, just have a look at it. It's lamprey and hagfish. So here you can have a look at the picture of lamprey and hagfish. So friends, before we move on, let me just elaborate on a particular term that might be used elsewhere else. So it is called spawning process or spawning. It is in itself a process. Now let me just tell you what it is, S-P-A-W-N-I-N-G. So what happens is we know that the process of fertilization takes place when eggs and sperm meet. Okay, so eggs are actually laid by the females. It is a laid by female reproductive organs, and sperm is from the male reproductive organs. So when there is a mating of both these things, there is a process of fertilization that take place. Right, now the process of releasing these eggs and sperms inside the water for fertilization is referred to as a spawning process. Okay, so now we were discussing Cyclostomata class. So this lamprey and hagfish, basically they are marine organisms. Okay, that is they live in seawater. But for this process of spawning, they migrate to fresh water. Okay, so this is one just a point which I have mentioned, because in many places you would find that some of the fishes are actually staying in a particular environment, but for this process of spawning, they migrate to another environment. Okay, so that is why I thought we can clear this process out here, so that whenever you encounter this particular word, you are familiar with what is the process involved in it. So now we have come to the two important classes, which are under the superclass of Pisces. Okay, we have seen the hierarchy. If you haven't got hold of it, kindly have a look at the picture that we had discussed. Okay, so we'll just quickly see the differences, and then we shall appreciate what are the important points that each has. So when you talk about chondrichthyes, basically they have cartilaginous endoskeleton, and osteichthyes have bony endoskeleton. So difference is between having cartilage tissue and bony tissue. Now, first thing, when we talk about endoskeleton, it is the basic framework of body, right? Like how we human beings have a skeleton on which there is muscles and the flesh growing, right? So similarly, we are talking about the body framework. So what happens is usually there are connecting tissues which are there. Okay, that help to connect various tissues in the body. It connects bone to bone. It also connects bones with muscles. Okay, so basically just keep in mind that we are talking about certain connecting tissues. Okay, so these connecting tissues can be either cartilaginous or bony. Okay, so when you talk about cartilage, these are very thin connecting tissues. Okay, they are flexible. Okay, but when I say bones, they are not flexible, they are hard. Okay, there are very other differences, but just on the outer level, you need to know this much is more than enough for us. Okay, so the fishes that contain this cartilage tissues are falling under the class of chondrichthyes, and those that contain the bones as the connecting tissues, they are falling under the class of osteichthyes. So this is the difference between the two. Then, other important point is, the cartilaginous fishes, they are mostly marine fishes. They are marine fishes, and the bony fishes, they can be both marine and freshwater. Okay. Next thing is, in the class chondrichthyes, there is absence of air bladder. Okay. So what they have to do is, they need to keep swimming constantly to avoid sinking. The presence of air bladder helps in balancing the fishes even when they are not swimming. Okay. So this air bladder is present in bony fishes. Next, we are talking about fertilization, the mode of it. Okay, so we have just seen that when eggs and sperm come together or mate, there is a process which results in formation of the young one, the start of the formation of the young one, and that process is known as fertilization. Now, this particular fertilization that is taking place can either be internal or it can be external. So, when I say internal, that fertilization process is taking place inside the female body. Okay, when I say external, it is taking place in the external environment. In our case, it is water. Okay, so for chondrichthyes, it is taking place internally inside the body of the female fish. Okay, and for osteichthyes, this is taking place externally. We just had a look at the process of spawning, where the process of releasing the eggs and the sperms into the water for fertilization. Okay, that process is known as spawning. Then we come to osteichthyes, that is bony fish. They are further classified into ray finned group and lobe finned group. Now, this classification is based on the type of fins they have. Don't need to go into the details. Next, moving to examples. Okay, just have a look at the examples. Don't just try and memorize them, but just have an idea regarding it. Okay, now here you can see freshwater fishes. These are Rohu, Katla, and Clarius or Magur. These are very famous names, and you would be encountering them again when we are going to have a discussion regarding the main topic of the classification of the fishery resources. So kindly just register in your mind right now that these particular fish, Rohu, Katla, these come under the class osteichthyes. That means you need to be aware that they are the bony fishes. They can be marine or they can be freshwater fishes also. Okay, and then there is a presence of air bladder, which helps it to actually maintain balance. Then the fertilization is usually external. Okay, so just have these points in mind. Next, you can have a look at the pictures of the examples that we had seen. So under chondrichthyes, the examples can be dogfish, sawfish, great white shark, stingray. Then moving out on the examples of osteichthyes, this is flying fish, seahorse, rohu, clarias. So friends, we have come to the second section of this particular video, that is regarding the classification of ocean zones. Now the question comes out here that why do we need to study these classification? So friends, the thing is, when we are going to have a look at the classification of the fishery resources, what is going to happen is you want to encounter certain terms like maybe pelagic fish. Okay, so what happens is, at that point of time, you might be wondering, what is this pelagic fish, right? And the answer to this is, the fish that lives in the pelagic zone. Okay, now the question, from where did this pelagic zone come from? Okay, so it is a particular zone that is there in the ocean. So instead of asking so many questions when we reach the main document, it is better that beforehand we have a rough idea regarding the various zones that are present in ocean. Okay, so it would help us to read that particular document. So what we are going to do is, we're going to just have a look at the names of the zones, and we're just going to quickly see the depth, and we're not going to go into the detail of each. Okay, so if you talk about the zones, they can be either horizontal classification or vertical. Okay, so first let us have a look at horizontal. So on the left you can see a picture. You don't need to know each and every feature that is mentioned in it, but just have a look at the possibility of so many features existing on the ocean floor. Plus you can see the various components of the horizontal classification. Okay, so it is starting from continent, it is moving to shelf, slope, then you have a continent rise, you have a feature like mid-ocean ridge out here, there is this trench which is formed. Okay, you have an island arc. So these are the features which you can encounter on the ocean floors. Okay, but we shall have a look at only continental margin. Okay, that is enough for us. So at the right side, you can see a picture which gives you the various components of this continental margin. So basically, what is this continental margin? So we are talking about that part of the continent or that area of the continent which is usually submerged underwater. Okay, now this particular area has the following components. Like when I talk about continental shelf, I'm referring to a particular area which is nearly 200 meter from the shoreline. Okay, like from the shore till 200 meter runs. Then there is a steep slope which occurs, and this particular slope we call it as continental slope. And the end of the slope, okay, the steepness ends at a particular point. Okay, so you can call it as continental break. Okay, after that there is a gentle slope that is there. Okay, here it was very steep, and then you have a gentle one that is a continental rise. Okay, so these are some of the components, just be familiar with it. Now let us just move on. Okay, so here I want to see at the vertical classification. So first, before going into the details of various zones, overall if you see on a broader basis, ocean zones can be classified into pelagic zone and benthic zone. When I say pelagic zone, I'm talking about the water column. Okay, and when I say benthic zone, I'm talking about the ocean floor. So if this is the continent and this is the ocean, okay. So when I say pelagic zone, I'm just talking about the water column. Okay, I'm just talking about the water column which is present above the ocean floor. Okay, and the organisms that reside in this pelagic zone, that is a water column that exists, are called nectins. And those organisms that reside on the ocean floor are referred to as benthos. So these are the terminologies that you need to relate to. Okay. So now moving on the pelagic zone classification. Okay. So now we have already seen that on a broader basis, you have a pelagic zone, that is a water column. Okay. The entire water column is referred to as pelagic zone, and the entire ocean floor is referred to as benthic zone. Okay, so this pelagic zone is further divided. So when you divide it, you get these classifications that you see, and we can divide it based on the light penetration that takes place from the surface. Okay, so first zone is epipelagic. Now from zero level, take the sea surface to be zero, it moves downwards towards 200 meters. This is the epipelagic zone. Obviously, since it is a topmost zone, it is going to be having the prevalence of sunlight. Okay, then moving on to mesopelagic zone. Okay, again, it is the measurement is from 200 meter to 1000 meter. Okay, then we have bathypelagic zone or bathypelagic zone. There is no light that is observed in this particular zone, okay, and it is known as the midnight zone as well. It is from 1000 to 4000 meter. Then we move on to abyssopelagic. It is between 4000 to 6000. And finally, we have 6000 to 10000, that is a head of pelagic zone. You can have a look at in the picture. So very simple classification. So based on the depth, you can classify it into five zones. So just remember the names. Okay, there might be these might be used many times when we are referring to various fishes. So when we say pelagic zone, we can immediately relate that the fishes which are found in the water column of an ocean are referred to as pelagic fishes. Okay, then we shall see further divisions of it as well in the other video that we shall be discussing. So right now this is more than enough for us. So friends, after having a look at the various zones or divisions of pelagic zone, let us just see yet another classification. So this depends upon the presence of sunlight. Okay, the ocean can be classified into photic zone and aphotic zone. Okay, it's a very simple division. Let us just go slow with it. So when I talk about this photic zone, I'm going to be having a look at two further zones under it. One is the euphotic zone and the other is a dysphotic. Okay, so we are dealing with four terms, photic, euphotic, dysphotic and aphotic. So under photic zones, the classification is euphotic and dysphotic. So when I say euphotic zone, this particular zone is a zone where there is enough of sunlight. Okay, and the organisms that are living in this particular zone can make use of that particular sunlight for the process of photosynthesis. Okay, so the light available is usable. When you talk about dysphotic zone, in this zone also the light is present, but it is faint and filtered. Okay, because water keeps absorbing light, and with the increase in depth, the availability of sunlight decreases. Okay, so here if you see in the daytime, there is sunlight that is present, but that particular sunlight cannot be utilized by the organisms for the process of photosynthesis. That much availability is not there. Okay, it can only make you see in the daylight. That is it. Okay, and because euphotic zone has the prevalence of sunlight and organisms can use it for photosynthesis, there are so many organisms that are actually present in this particular zone. But in dysphotic zone, because they cannot effectively utilize it for the process of photosynthesis, we have very less organisms that reside in this particular zone of ocean. Okay, so now let us just see the depth to which generally photic zone exists. So when I talk about euphotic zone, the depth is going to be 0 to 200 meter. And this is coinciding with, if you have remembered the classification properly, so we have just now discussed the various divisions of pelagic zone. So we have seen that the first zone or the division was 0 to 200 meter epipelagic zone. So this is coinciding with our euphotic zone. Right, and when you talk about dysphotic zone, it is going to be 200 to 1000 meter. So immediately you need to correlate, we are talking about which zone out here. We are talking about the mesopelagic zone, which is also known as the twilight zone. Okay, and when we say the aphotic zone, it is completely dark zone. So after 1000 meters, there is no prevalence of sunlight, not even faint. Okay, and there's one more thing which you can note, friends. When you talk about euphotic zone, it means actually well lit zone. And when you say dysphotic zone, it refers to poorly lit zone. Okay, now let us just move forward with the other classification. Okay, so now when we were talking about pelagic zone, we saw that it is the water column that we are talking about, right? So now there is another classification of this pelagic zone, which is horizontal. So in the previous sections, we had referred to the classification according to depth. Okay, as we move downwards, what are the various zones? Okay, now we are going to see horizontally what is the classification. There are only two zones when you talk about horizontal classification. One is the neritic zone and the oceanic zone. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll just draw a diagram and then we'll just have a look at it quickly. So suppose this is our continent and then it is submerged under water. This is our ocean floor, which is there. This is the continental shelf. Okay, so now what happens is we know that the entire water column is which is present here, not the floor. The entire water column is the pelagic zone, right? So the water that is there above the continental shelf, okay, maybe from 0 to 200 meter, that particular water or the zone is referred to as the neritic zone. So this zone lies about the continental shelf, and in the start of the ocean zone classification, we had seen that continental shelf is from 0 to 200 meters from the shore. Right? So now this water is actually lit relatively very good by the sunlight, and it is shallow. We can see there is not much of depth in this particular zone. Okay, and we can also see that majority of sea life, okay, it is present in this particular zone because it has good oxygen quantity, there is low pressure, the temperature is stable because it is not entirely marine environment. You see, it is nearer to the shore, okay, that being the reason. Then we talk about the ocean zone, oceanic. You can automatically see the remaining water column that is left, okay, till the floor, that is referred to as oceanic zone. Okay, so it begins after 200 meter. So obviously, because it is very deep, it also contains certain volcanoes and other features. Okay, so you just need to know a very broad overview, and you need to be aware of the name that is that we are using out here. Okay, so now you can just quickly have a look. We have seen what is neritic, we have seen what is oceanic. Right, so this was the horizontal classification of this pelagic zone. We have also seen the vertical classification of this pelagic zone entirely, that is epipelagic, meso, bathypelagic, epizoopelagic and hedal pelagic. Okay, so friends, now coming to the classification of benthic zone, this is the last one that we're going to have a look at. So at the start, we had seen that on a broader level, there are two important classification of ocean. One is the pelagic zone and one is the benthic. Pelagic, we had seen that it is talking about the water column. And when we talk about benthic zone, we are referring to the ocean floor. Okay. So this ocean floor can also be divided into various sections. So the first thing you need to note that whenever there is so much of energy in the ocean and there the wind movement is very fast, okay, at that moment the wave motions are very huge, okay, and the water reaches to a greater level on the continent. So the point to which the water comes is known as high tide. And when there is not much of a movement in the waves, it actually comes to a point which is the lowest for it, that is referred to as low tide. Okay, so the region between this high tide and low tide is known as the littoral zone. Okay, and above this high tide, whatever zone we have, that is known as supralittoral. And this littoral zone is nothing but the intertidal zone. Okay, now let us just have a look at the other picture so that we can make sense of the other sections of this particular benthic floor, benthic zone. Now friends, have a look at this picture and just understand that this is a water column in blue color that you're having a look at, right? So we have seen the various classification of this pelagic zone into divisions like, you know, epipelagic, mesopelagic, and this depended upon the depth. The same classification is possible for sea floor also, that is a benthic zone that we are talking about. Just I will give you an example of one zone, like if you can see the last zone that we were discussing in pelagic, that is a hedal pelagic, the depth was 6000 meter to 1000 meter, right? The same corresponding zone in the sea floor or the benthic region is a Hadean division. Okay, so it is going to be similar case for abyssal. It is going to be the abyssopelagic zone when you refer it to water column division, and the same corresponding division in the sea floor is going to be abyssal. So this is going to continue. So just correlate it with the zones of the pelagic region. Okay, that is why you can see the similarity in the names also. It is starting with HAD and here also it is HAD. Same thing abyss and here also abyss. So the depth is going to be the same, the names are going to be different. And why are they different? Because in the first case we are talking about the divisions in the water column. In the second case we are talking about the divisions in the sea floor. Okay. So yes, we are done with all the classifications possible. So we will just quickly see the names, and you need to be by now able to revise. So now this is, before we just end, you need to understand that these are some of the basic terms that you need to just understand on a very superficial level. You don't need to go deep into it. If you watch this video once and you just have a look at the document once, that's more than enough. You do not need to revise it again and again, because this is not going to be a direct question in your examination, but it's going to help you to read the other important things that are relevant for the examination. Okay, so just pause the video for yourself, have a look at all these terms, and by now you should have understood the meaning of each and every term on a superficial level at least. So friends, with this we have come to the end of this particular video, where we had a discussion regarding the taxonomy of fish and the various zones of ocean. Thank you friends, and happy learning.